In the last video that we just put up on the problems with water, and this is a real difficulty, the hydrological difficulty that we call it, the fact that there just is no water in a desert, and if there's no water, of course, there is no food, no food, no people, no people, no towns, no towns, no cities, no cities, no civilization, no civilization, no history. That's the difficulty, as we mentioned in the last video. But it goes beyond that, because the comeback that we're getting from Muslims, and we got a few who are on the comments section, said, yes, but the Zamzam well is there. The Zamzam well is more than adequate. We need to shut that one down as well. So I'm just going to put up my PowerPoint. I'm going to show you how is it and what is the problem with the Zamzam well. It's got some historical problems. It's also got some hydrological problems. And also you will see the claims that are made for it. I'm going to start with a claim by David Chappelle, he is a well-known comedian. Most of you, probably a lot of you, maybe have seen some of his shows. He's been very controversial with things that he's been saying about women or transgender people. But I'm not interested in that part of who he is or what he's saying. I'm interested in what he said to David Letterman on stage when asked this question about this well, Zamzam. Watch this, and then I'll come back and I'll start unpacking exactly what he is saying, but the implications of what he is saying, and really whether or not he should be saying this about the Zamzam well, because he's not alone. There are many people who are making this claim about the Zamzam well. Right, here he is.
So I'm reading about you being Muslim, and they reference something that I was fascinated by, the well of Zamzam.
There's a well called ZamZam, Saudi Arabia.
And the myth goes that a family walking through this desert, dying of thirst, and this endless well presents itself. You and I could go see it.
Right, so I could go see it. You'd probably have to make some phone calls.
have you been there?
I have.
It's only welcome to Muslims. It's not a tourist location.
No, nor should it be. The man is the Prophet Abraham and his wife. The word Zamzam, you guys speak Arabic, literally means stop, stop, because when it was commanded that this well would appear, the water gushed forth so much that the wine screams, stop, stop, because it was so overwhelming. And they say that it's an inexhaustible well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, did you all get that? So what do they claim about this Zamzam? Well, let's just call it Zamzam. Well, in the comments section, whenever I talk about the Zamzam well, they were very clear. The Zamzam well refutes any notion that Mecca had no water. There was plenty of water, and this water, as he said, is inexhaustible. Did you hear David Chappelle, who is a convert to Islam? He's a very well-known comic here, been very controversial in the last few months. But he is a very clever man and a very intelligent man. And yet he says this water is inexhaustible. That's why we know that there has always been water in Mecca. Others say it was from the time of Adam and Eve. It was very clear that David Chappelle said it's the time of Abraham, at least, because it was sprouting out there when Hagar was looking for water for her son Ishmael. Goes back from Safa and Marwa, Safa and Marwa. And when you go to Mecca today, you will see they run back and forth seven times because they're commemorating that event, looking for water. According to the current narrative, Hagar is the one that found it, and she had to say, stop, stop, because it was gushing out so much, as he said there in that clip. And it's inexhaustible. That's why there is so much of it. It is furthermore the world's cleanest and purest water. It can accommodate every pilgrim who comes to Mecca. It is bottled and used by millions all around the world. And you all know this. Go to any Muslim shop, wherever you are in the world, go into the Muslim shop, even a bookshop, and you'll see bottles of Zamzam well there on the shelves. You can buy them in every shop all over the world. You can buy Zamzam well. Why? Because it is holy water, and it is used to... People use it to be healed, and they use it as gifts, and they use it as very considered to be highly priced. And when you sip it, it even has it even tastes sweet. It has that sweetness, proof that it is holy water. I took this article from Spotlight News in 2020, written by Nada Hamid from Jeddah, and he talks about this very well written article. And he says that the well has been around for thousands of years, and he makes lots of claim in this article. He claims that it sprang up about 5,000 years ago when Hagar went looking for water for Ishmael, so that's about 1900 BC. And he claims that she ran between Safa Mount 7 times before finding the Zamzam well. And as David said in that clip, yes, it means stop flooring or stop, stop. Water from the well has no impurities with minerals and a heavy taste, he said. Pilgrims buy it, and it is shipped all over the world for its healing properties. And that's why you can get it in all the marketplace, and that's why you can get it in all the books or all the stores. You can get it here, I'm sure, where you all live. Go and see if you can find any Zamzam water. It costs about $187 million to modernize the well to accommodate the pilgrims, because you get so many pilgrims coming. 2 million pilgrims come every year, which... with the 2 million that are already living there, that explodes the population to 4 million every year. They all drink Zamzam water. 350 million liters of water is pumped from Zamzam during the Ramadan. That's just the time of Ramadan. That's about roughly 11 million a day. 11 million liters of water are pumped a day during the Ramadan period. During the Hajj, where there's 314 million liters of water is pumped from Zamzam during the Hajj. That's 52 million liters a day. That's even more per day, because there's many more people there in that smaller spot. Ramadan's longer. And therefore, as they all the Muslims claim, and you'll hear a lot of Muslims claim it, it never runs out. It'll remain there eternally running. Allah himself will supply it for eternity. And this is the claim that Nada Hamid is making in this article, and you'll hear Muslims say this all over the world. So what do we know about this well? Let's look and do a little historical survey. So I went up and did a little historical survey to find out what we do, and I did actually a video on this about 2 years ago. We don't know very much. There's just nothing there. What we do know is this is the oldest picture of it from 1800s. Take a look at that. Can you see? It's only about 30 feet across. Look at the people looking down. It's not very, very wide. It doesn't look like very much of a well, only about 30 feet across. So that can supply 4 million people with water every day, 314,000 liters, 52 million liters a day, that little well. Looking down into the well, this is what it looks like. In 1950s, you can look down. In the 1950s, that they resurfaced it, and you can see it only looks down about 50 meters, and there's just a little bit of water at the bottom there. And you can see steps going down to it. That's where the people would go down to get water out. Hardly doesn't look like much. Doesn't look like it accommodate 52 million liters a day. Not that. Not in the 1950s. In 1953, they put a cover over top of it. And there you can see a man is drawing out pail by pail by pail. Each one has to be drawn up and then back down and then drawn back up again. That's when I was born, in 1953. A building was then constructed over the well at night in the same year, so the pilgrims could go, and only the pilgrims who were there could go, and then they would drink from it, but they would have to pay a heavy price because there was very little of it. So that in 1963, they completely reconstructed the whole thing, and they put the well down underneath. They put it underground. So they raised that building you see there in 1953, 10 years later, raised it and reconstructed it so that it was all underground. Today, there's a little circle. If you go there, you can see the little circle which marks the spot where the Zamzam well used to be. Now it's directly below it, underground today. And Al-Fadi, who has been there many times, and he's been to the well, and he's seen it. You're not allowed to go down to the well itself. That's off limits now. You'll see why. So today, if you go to the Zamzam Museum, which is there at the Masjid al-Haram, which is there in the Kaaba, right outside the Kaaba, you can go to the. This is from inside the museum. There is the cap, the Willstone cap. That they used, and there's a whole museum that is dedicated to the Zamzam well now there in Mecca. Now here's a question, a niggling problem that I brought up in my video and was never answered. See if you guys and gals can answer this. In 1963, when they moved the well underground, they dug it deeper. So they dug it down to 31 meters, even deeper than what it used to be, much deeper, in fact. It is now only situated, in fact, it's always been situated only 21 meters from the Kaaba. Can you see? It's just a few meters from the Kaaba, 21 meters. Doesn't the well commemorate Hagar searching and then finding water in the desert for Ishmael in 1900 BC? Isn't that why that well was created? Isn't that where she finally found the water and came burbling back up? And aren't the two rocks that she runs back and forth, the two mountains, Safa and Marwa, where she runs back to look for this water, and then she comes back to Ishmael, who she leaves behind, and there's the water burbling up out of the ground. So that's to commemorate that event? Isn't that what everybody says? Isn't that what I just read about 10 minutes ago? But if Abraham lived next to the Kaaba, which means Abraham lived in Mecca, then what was Hagar doing only 21 meters away? If she had been thrown out of Mecca by Abraham out into the desert, she was all by herself. She's way out in the desert, right? Shouldn't she be miles away when she finds this water? If she was still in Mecca and she's looking for water, all she had to do is go to the next nearest house. There were houses all around the Kaaba, just knocking the door, says, I need some water for my son. Why is it that this well where she finds water is only 21 meters away? So this suggests a rather convenient man-made well, or is it nothing more than a facsimile? Does the well supply all the water the needs of Mecca? Now let's get to the next question. This is the other big one. If it is inexhaustible and supplies all the needs for all the Muslims, 1.8 billion Muslims around the world, does it supply all those needs for the Muslim world? That's the next question. Remember, Mecca has 2 million inhabitants all year round. It's the fourth largest city in Arabia after Riyadh and after Jeddah and after, what's the fourth one? There's one in between up north. I can't remember what it is. And then you have Mecca. So it's the fourth largest, most populated city in Arabia, Saudi Arabia, 2 million inhabitants. But during the Hajj, 2 million comes. So it doubles to 4 million during the Hajj, 4 million people. Mecca needs 1.4 liters per second for its just for its population. That's equivalent to 51 Olympic-sized pools every day. Every day, just supply its 2 million residents. Yet the Zamzam well only supplies 19 liters per second. And that's only after it rains. So where do they get all the water for the 2 million people? Meccans, as well as the 2 million pilgrims, as well as the many million, more a billion Muslims who buy and drink it around the world in almost every one of your shops. I mean, we're talking about possibly 1.5 billion liters that they need for the whole world. Not from that well, not from that, just 30 feet across, not that's just 31 meters down. You can't get it from something that small. Where does the Zamzam water come from? You'd like to know, wouldn't you? Well, I found the answer, and I put it up on YouTube, and no Muslim since the last year and a half has been able to come back. Here's the answer. I just Googled it, and this is what I found. In the 1950s, the well was not very deep and had very little water, as its entrance was just about 30 feet across, like I said. Today, however, it's now underground. No one can get near it, as it now has been capped completely, and it has a pump installed at the top of the well with pipes coming to and pipes coming from. You can see the picture of the pipes here. There they are. This is all free. You can go on Google and look and Google it yourself. Here are the pictures of the pipes going into the well and coming out of the well. So if they're going into the well and out of the well, obviously the water is not coming originally from the well, right? Seems these pipes bring the water to the well from where it is then pumped back out to the various locations in the Masjid al-Haram and onto the bottling plants. But from where does this water originate, if not from the Zamzam well itself? Or is this the miracle that everybody's talking about? Is this the miracle that of Allah that David Chappelle is referring to in that little clip that we have? And is this what Nazam is saying when he wrote that article, that this is inexhaustible and Allah provides it? Is that the case? Maybe that's what's going on here. Well, I wanted to find out. I found out where it comes from. It comes from these desalination plants. These are some of the largest desalination plants in the world, and they're right there in Jeddah and all along the coast. They take the water from the Red Sea. They bring it into those big, you can see them over there on the right. They bring it through every one of those ducts there, and then they desalinize and taking all the salt out, and pushing the fresh water in through those huge pipes, those green pipes you see there, where they're refining it. Take a look at this map. This is open knowledge. They're not trying to hide this. There are 27 of these desalination plants all around the west coast of Arabia and the east coast, but mostly on the west coast. Why? Because those are the ones that supply Mecca, and they supply Jeddah, and they supply also Medina. Medina is the other city I was looking for. On the right side, you have the Persian Gulf. There's only four desalination plants, and they are the ones that desalinate the water for Riyadh, which is the capital. But the vast majority are on the West Coast. Only 4 on the East Coast. The other 23 are on the West Coast. These are desalination plants. That's where the water comes from. And then they take from Jeddah, they then shoot it in through those huge pipes to these holding tanks. Those are the world's largest water storage units anywhere in the world. They're right outside of Mecca. There you can see they're still building them because they got to keep up with the demand. Enormous. Those are not oil tanks. Those are water tanks. And from those water tanks, then they refine it again and they purified it and they put the sweetener in it. It's all done in these holding tanks. They put the sweetener in, which is then sent down to Mecca. And so only a bit of it is sent to Mecca. To the Masjid al-Haram. Most of it is sent to these bottling plants. Notice that all of these desalination plants are built by 3 companies, Acciona from Canada, Bechtel from United States, and Black & Veatch from United States. This has nothing to do with Allah. Thus, the Zamzam water is American, Spanish, and Canadian made and has nothing to do with Meccan Zamzam well, has nothing to do with Allah. And there you can see the bottling plants where they then come, huge bottling plants all around Mecca and Jeddah, where they then ship them all over the world so that everybody can have access to Zamzam water. And the Saudi Arabians are laughing all the way to the bank. They're making a huge profit out of this. But it has nothing to do with Allah. It has everything to do with American technology and Canadian technology. And now look at the amount of desalinated water for each city. What it shows very clearly is that Mecca, the city of Mecca, the desalinated water is 98% of all its water. For Medina, which is further north, it is 95%. So in almost every case, except for Qassim and Riyadh, which is over on the east side, where there's much more water, that's on the east side of Arabia, the water on the west side is almost non-existent. And that's why they need those desalination plants. Now you can see why it's important that you do the research, and it's important that we see where the water is coming from. It is not at all coming. So where is it coming from and where is it stored? So that's the next question. Now, here is a modern Google map of Mecca today, okay? So where is this water stored? Obviously, when you look down at Mecca, there you can see the Masjid al-Haram. I just circled it in red. That is where the Kaaba is. Here you can see the Mina tent city. That's where 2 million people come. When they come to Mecca, that's where the majority of them live, in those tent cities. Others live in large skyscrapers and beautiful air-conditioned hotels, the richer ones. This is where the pilgrims live. There you can see the 3 jamarats. You don't know what I'm talking about. That will come out later. That's where the 3 jamarats are, where the pilgrims stone the devil. And then over here is Mount Arafat. Arafat is where they go to, the mountain that they go to do their prayers. So with 4 million people, remember there are 2 million people living in Mecca during the year. 2 million come during the Hajj. So that makes 4 million people. Where in the world do they all this water come from? Well, if you look carefully at the map I'm showing you right there, you can see it. I don't know if any of you have picked it up, but look carefully at the map there on the right and see if you can see some storage tanks. Let me help you. Here they are. I've just now put a blue rectangle around it, and I've now given you an arrow going to it. That is the Muna bulk reservoir tanks. That is the largest single reservoir anywhere in the world. And it's up on the hill that's away, that's looking down onto the tent city, where the Mina tent city is. Let's take a look at it more closely. And there you can see it. It's actually 7 tanks, but the biggest one there in the middle, you can see it from the side in the bottom picture, the biggest one is the world's largest storage tanks. So they store 1 million cubic feet of water. This is where all the water that they use for the pilgrimage and for the people who actually live in Mecca during the year round. Now, where does the water for the Muna storage tanks come from? It doesn't come from anywhere in Mecca. That's where they store it. Where do they get it from? They get it from these tanks. These are the Brimman reservoirs in Jeddah. Remember, we talked about Jeddah. It is Jeddah where all the desalination takes place to supply Jeddah and to supply Mecca. And these are the world's largest. They've just broken the Guinness World Record as the largest storage tanks, not for oil, for water. And you can see there are 11 of them. There are two that are under construction, two more that are going to be even bigger than the ones that are there. So who builds these water tanks? Who builds all of these pipes? And how do they get them from Jeddah up to Mecca? It is the Atkins team from the Vinci Construction Company from the United Kingdom. There's a picture of them right there. I've got a picture of the people who actually built those tanks. They are not Saudi Arabian. They are British. This is not from Allah. It is not some everlasting water that is unplenishable. It actually comes from British technology for these storage tanks. So we talked about the desalination tanks, even storing them. They are dependent on the Europeans in this case for their storages. So where did the water from Mecca come from subsequent to the 8th century? That was another question that came up last week. What about after the 8th century? What about after the fact, after Mecca was discovered and it had no water? What happened there? Well, to answer that, you need to go to this lady here, Queen Zubaydah. Queen Zubaydah. She is the one who was the wife of Al-Rashid, who died in 799. So he died in the late 8th century. They lived in Iraq. She went down to Mecca. This is in the, we're talking about the 8th century. So this is long after Mecca had been chosen as the sanctuary. And she noticed that there was just no water there. The very problem we've been trying to tell people, there's just no water there. And so because of the fact that she was dedicated to do something about it, she built this, what they call the Wadi Numan Aqueduct, or this is the Kanat, the Wadi Numan Kanat. There's the aqueduct. And she built it in between 791 to 801, so it took 10 years to build. Her husband died in 799, so he died while she was having it built. Now, interestingly, the Numan Kanat aqueduct went from the Wadi called Numan, which I have circled down here in the far bottom right. There's the Wadi Numan, to the Al-Aziziya neighborhood. And there, I'm just going to show you a map. I'm sorry, a line. There's the line between Wadi Numan and Al-Aziziya. Do you see it there, the blue line? It is about 23 miles, supplies 600 to 800 cubic meters of water a day. Now, that's what it's doing. That was what it was up to. Remember, you need almost 4 million today. This would never, of course, would supply water for today. But back in those days, when there were not that many pilgrims, that was adequate to supply water. Now, it's a valley where water would come very infrequently, and it would come from Taif, which is way up 3,000 feet up to the north. Now, in 952, Ja'far ibn al-Mu'tasim had to refurbish this aqueduct because it was in disrepair. So that was in 952. In 1236, the Emir Shuban put a 50,000 dinars to refurbish it. This was refurbished again in 1328 by al-Nasir Muhammad bin Kalawun. And then in 1410, it had to be rebuilt all over again by the Egyptian king al-Mu'ayyid. That was then rebuilt by another Egyptian king, the Sultan Kanush al-Guri, in 1510. In 1578, the Sultan Suleiman, the first daughter, Mihrima Sultan, another woman. Remember, the first was a woman, Queen Zubaydah. Now another one, woman came in to refurbish the aqueduct and get it going again. And then in 1818, the Wahhabis occupied Mecca, and they caused so much damage there that it went into disrepair. The last time that it finally had to be refurbished was by the Ayub Sabri Basa, who is an Ottoman naval officer. There's the map that he used at that time to refurbish and rebuild this aqueduct so that it could supply water to Mecca. But even that was not adequate. And that's why, and finally, in 1926, the last century, King Abdulaziz commissioned the desalination process because they just could not get enough water from even Taif and the other mountains up to the north to supply Mecca. So this has been an ongoing problem for Mecca. Mecca is just the wrong place for people to live, and certainly even a worse place for people to go to pilgrimage if you want to feed them and want to keep them watered. Right, so what can we say about the water problem in Mecca. Obviously, from the pictures that we have seen, Mecca was the wrong place. They should never have chosen Mecca. They should have thought in advance what would happen there in the future because of all of the pilgrims that were needed to be fed, needed to be watered, the vegetation that is needed to just keep the people supplied. There is just no water there. There's no water, there's no food, as we said earlier, no food, no people, no people, no towns, no towns, no cities, no cities, no civilization, no civilization, no history. And it's a curious thing that we brought up over and over again. This is not unique. When you look at Las Vegas here in the United States, you can see that Las Vegas, it's been planted in the middle of a desert as well. You want to put it in a place where there's nothing else there so that you don't have any restrictions and also you can pretty well start from scratch. So you can see why Mecca was chosen. There's nothing there. There's no history. There is nothing to get in the way and there was nothing to stop it. So like Las Vegas, they could create anything they want. You go to Las Vegas, you'll find a pyramid there. You'll find an Eiffel Tower, not the original pyramid, not the original Eiffel Tower. Just like you don't have the original Kaaba in Mecca. That actually is in Jerusalem. You don't have the original Safa and Marwa mountains. Those are just, they're not mountains at all. They're nothing more than rocks about 20 feet high. Facsimiles. The original Zamzam well? No, it's possibly, it could be the Pool of Siloam in Jerusalem again. It's fascinating that David Chappelle, when asked the question about the Zamzam well, however, said very clearly, and as an intelligent man who grew up here in the United States, and with all the education that he's had, he still believed that this is inexhaustible, that it always is supplied, that it doesn't matter how many millions of people use that water, Allah, in his providence, will always supply that water. And he just said that rather flippantly, but he believed it. You can tell by the clip that he believed it. Yet when you look at the history of the Zamzam well, you will see that it's just too small. 30 feet wide at the top, maybe 50 feet at the beginning when the first pictures were taken in the 1800s. We know that it was so inadequate that Queen Zubaydah, back in the 8th century, moving into the 9th century, had to actually create that aqueduct, the Kanat, Zubaydah's Kanat, so that it could supply water coming down from Taif, from up in the mountains, down to certainly what we know today as Mecca. Even when the pilgrims started coming in their millions, as they are today, there was a real dilemma. Even as early as 1926, they tried to repair and the aqueduct so many times. Finally, in 1926, they gave up. There just was no way they could get enough water to supply the pilgrims. And that's why they then had to go to the desalination. Very crude desalination back in the 1920s, that's for sure. Today we've come a long ways. We're over 100 years, or almost 100 years now to that time. And it's not Allah that's supplying this water. This is a big misnomer. I wish David Chappelle would stop saying this. I wish that all these people around here in the West would stop saying this. It has nothing to do with Allah. It has everything to do with really three major companies, Bechtel in Virginia here in the United States, Acciona from Canada, also in Spain, and then the Black & Veatch from Kansas City. Those are the companies that have really created the technology so that the Saudi Arabian government can build these 27 desalination plants all around the borders. They have to be where the water is, and the water is salty, and because of that, that's where they have to build them so that they can supply the four major cities in Saudi Arabia, and especially Jeddah and Mecca, where most of the people live. 2 million who live there in Mecca alone. 54 million liters of water a day during the Hajj, when another 2 million join them. 4 million, 54 million liters. No wonder the Americans were needed. The American technology and European technology was needed to supply what Muslims today claim comes from Allah. Even those tanks, remember the tanks that I just showed? Those water tanks, those aren't even indigenous. Those come from the Vinci Construction Company, and it's the Aitkins team that actually were the ones that designed it and built it and broke the world record for the largest storage tanks, water tanks, not oil this time, water tanks. So when Muslims come up and keep telling us that this is all coming from God, this is coming from Allah, you now know, and you can now tell them this has nothing to do with Allah. It has everything to do with Western technology. Thank God for Western technology. Give credit where credit is due. And let's stop this lying all the time about how Allah provides everything for everybody in all places. Not at all. If the Western technology wasn't there, they wouldn't even be able to live there, let alone the pilgrims would not be able to go there. It's because we supply the water that gives the food, that gives makes it a town, that makes it a city, that makes it a civilization so that they can have their history. Well, it's because Western technology has done that for the Arabian government and for the Muslims around the world. Please give us some credit. God bless you. This is Jay. Over and out.